Welcome to Presidential Libraries, Museums, and More. I'm your host, Patrick Clark. It's President's Day, a day to honor our great nation's commander-in-chiefs, and it's been an historic 12 months.
We have a new 46th president, Joe Biden, and the first African-American vice president, Kamala Harris. This after a tumultuous end of term for former President Donald Trump that saw the storming of the Capitol, Washington, D.C., an act of violence that's not happened there in over 200 years. It was called the War of 1812. That's the last time the Capitol was under siege. Here's where it all started. Conflict grew between America and Great Britain when United Kingdom began implementing several naval policies that heavily restricted trade by the United States. That included harassing ships at sea and even forcibly removing American sailors to serve in the British Navy. When James Madison was elected president in 1808, he instructed Congress to begin preparing for another war with Britain. Congress voted to declare war against the British on June 18, 1812. The fighting began in July and would last for over two more years. On August 24, 1814, British troops led by Major General Robert Ross marched into Washington City, now Washington, D.C., after defeating American forces at the Battle of Bladensburg. It was one of the worst defeats in American military history. The American troops, despite their greater numbers, were outmatched. Forces fled in disarray, leaving Washington nearly undefended. With a clear path to Washington in front of them, close to 4,000 British redcoats and Royal Marines marched onward to the American capital. At the height of that conflict, several government buildings were burned, including the Treasury, the Executive Mansion, the Library of Congress, and the Capitol. The Executive Mansion, now known as the White House, still has scorch marks left behind that can be seen in history books today. The British say only government buildings were burned to show they only had issues with U.S. authorities, not the American people. Now, over 200 years later, our nation's capital comes under siege again. This time, the chaos in the capital caused by division in our own nation, all leading to another historic moment, the second impeachment of a United States president. With a stroke of her pen, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi held up what is now a historic document, the first ever second impeachment of a U.S. president. Many Democrats blame President Trump for the recent attack on the U.S. Capitol. 10 Republicans join with him. The only presidents in U.S. history to be impeached were Andrew Johnson, Bill Clinton, and Donald Trump.
The fundamental difference between the Clinton impeachment and the Johnson impeachment was that Johnson's impeachment was about his public acts as president. Bill Clinton's impeachment was about his private acts while he was president. And in theory, the purpose of impeachment was to safeguard against a president either being corrupt or being a tyrant. The corruption and tyranny are the two principal concerns of the Founding Fathers that impeachment was supposed to prevent.
December 18, 2019, Donald John Trump was charged with abuse of power and obstruction of Congress.
The impeachment of Donald Trump has been framed entirely about his public actions as president. So rather than thinking about the legalistic specifics of this, I think the best way to understand the impeachment of Donald Trump is the accusation that he's used the instruments of government to advance his personal political aims.
Trump was impeached for the second time, approximately 1 year and 3 weeks apart. The second time for incitement of insurrection. President Donald J. Trump, now in a historical class of his own.
The storming of the U.S. Capitol, the president impeached a second time, and don't forget, all of this taking place during the COVID-19 pandemic. A short time ago, we marked the 157th anniversary of the Gettysburg Address by Abraham Lincoln. The Lincoln Library intended to display this handwritten copy, but the pandemic changed their plans.
47 years ago, so begins the Gettysburg Address.
272 words, it's by far probably the most famous political speech ever given in the English language.
This document is one of only five surviving copies written by President Abraham Lincoln. It was to have been taken out of its climate-controlled vault and displayed for 2 weeks in a dimly lit part of the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum. But the number of COVID cases nationwide on the rise has resulted in the popular presidential site having to close their doors temporarily.
We decided to opt not to display it this year. And so it will be on display. We create a virtual way you can go look at it. If you go to presidentlincoln@illinois.gov, you'll be able to see it as one of our current events.
A current event giving you a glimpse of another event in our nation's history, and virtual journeys into the words handwritten by the 16th U.S. President.
And a lot of that for him is wrapped up in the Emancipation Proclamation, that it's going to be a nation without slavery. And that's a lot of what the election of 1864, the next year, becomes about, is a referendum on whether the war is going to be about emancipation or not. So lots of links to today with, you know, party division and election, you know, all these things. You know, Lincoln's thinking about these things, too, in one of the most, well, the most divisive time in American history. I'm a historian. We have, you know, curators who work at the Presidential Library. To actually have a copy, to see those words written in Lincoln's own hand, it's an amazing thing. It's a shame people can't see it in person this year. Of course, we all understand the circumstances from that. But it's just a really powerful thing to see something that's just that connected to Lincoln and to something, you know, so well known and so special that he did.
We do want to note that the museum is back open to visitors with safety protocols in place, but the library portion of the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library is closed to visitors.
Speaking of connecting with our 16th president, a lock of President Lincoln's hair hit the auction block. The clippings were taken after he was assassinated on April 14, 1865. The hair, which is mounted on an official War Department telegram, was originally wrapped in a blood-stained telegram by a cousin of Lincoln's widow, who was also a doctor and Kentucky postmaster.
Visiting on that evening was Dr. Lyman Beecher Todd, who's Mary Todd Lincoln's cousin. So the next day, Dr. Todd goes to the autopsy and he's presented with this clipping of hair, of Lincoln's hair. In his pocket was a telegram dated April 14th, 1865, and he put the hair into that telegram. And what makes that telegram so significant is it's timestamped 11 p.m. And that put to rest all of these conspiracy theories that the telegraph lines had been cut.
Historians say the telegram disproved a conspiracy theory that then Secretary of War Edwin Stanton plotted to kill Lincoln because of their personal and political differences. At the time, some claimed that Stanton ordered military communications to be disrupted, allowing John Wilkes Booth to briefly elude his captors. The 2-inch lock of President Lincoln's hair and the blood-smeared telegram sold for more than $81,000 at an auction. Ahead on Presidential Libraries, Museums, and More, it's a staple in the Oval Office that's been handed down for decades, a piece of history that's still making history. We'll show you the Resolute Desk.
The Electoral College goes underground. I'll take you into this Missouri cavern that has connections to Jesse James and our 34th U.S. President.